morning and welcome to Forward, an annual symposium hosted by The Women's Place at The Ohio State University. I'm Andrea Williams, Director of The Women's Place and Associate Professor of English. Though today's program is virtual, I would like to begin with a land acknowledgement that gestures towards the physical premises on which Ohio State resides. We would like to acknowledge that the land the Ohio State University occupies is the ancestral and contemporary territory of the Shawnee, Potawatomi, Delaware, Miami, Peoria, Seneca, Wyandot, Ojibwe, and Cherokee peoples. Specifically, the university resides on land ceded in the 1795 Treaty of Greenville and the forced removal of tribes through the Indian Removal Act of 1830. We want to honor the resiliency of these tribal nations and recognize the historical contexts that have and continue to affect the indigenous peoples of this land. Thank you. Today's symposium builds on this reverence for historical context while aiming to strategically enhance and envision a present and future of access, justice, and equity. Housed within the Office of Diversity and Inclusion, the Women's Place offers programming to people of all genders with the goal of enhancing campus climate, increasing the representation of women and their allies in critical leadership roles, and influencing university policies and practices to make sure that Ohio State is a place where women and all people can thrive and make their best contributions. Our title for this year's symposium is Regaining Momentum for Gender Equity, Acknowledging the Loss, Cost, and Disruptions of the COVID-19 pandemic that is now entering its third year. Within weeks of the shutdowns in March 2020, commentators began to note the pandemic's social and economic toll on women. The Institute of Women's Policy Research referred to the pandemic-induced recession as a she-session, disproportionately impacting women in female-dominated sectors such as leisure and hospitality, education, and health services. According to Pew Research Center, nearly one in five women downshifted or left the workforce in the last 2 years. Between cuts in wages, frozen salaries, and unemployment, around $64.5 billion per year has been lost in wages and economic activity for working women. Meanwhile, women and other individuals who are caregivers have felt the demands of caring for children, elders, and other loved ones in the absence or suspension of social safety nets. Estimates suggest that women's professional and academic progress has been set back not just by 1 or 2 or even 3 years, the length of the pandemic itself, but by decades. Yet for as much as this crisis has been unsettling, it can also be a time to envision a new normal and regain momentum for gender equity. With this occasion and high calling for the exciting work of change, I again welcome you here today. In bringing together speakers from higher education, nonprofit, and the private sector, we deliberately extend our scope across and beyond Ohio State. We understand that the conditions in which we work, learn, and lead at universities are impacted by local, state, and federal policies and current events. Against the backdrop of political primaries, a global pandemic, ongoing calls for racial justice, and international war and humanitarian crises, today's program aims to highlight the importance of women's leadership and advocacy for equity in every sphere of everyday life. Our 9 a.m. session then shares strategies for advocacy in action. At 10, we'll be joined by speakers who consider how we can pivot towards hopeful and rewarding personal and professional growth in this moment of change. At 11, we will delve again into the institutional and structural changes that enable advancement for women, families, and everyone. And then our program culminates in a noon keynote by Selena Rezvani, two-time author, speaker, and leadership consultant who will encourage us to push back, advocate, and claim our best futures. To begin today's exciting activities, I'd like first to introduce Dr. Cynthia Turner as moderator of our first roundtable on promoting gender equity, advocacy, and action. Dr. Turner is Assistant Dean and Chief Diversity Officer at Fisher College of Business, where she also teaches in the Department of Accounting and Management Information Systems. She is a widely sought after facilitator, guest speaker, and thought partner for academic units and organizations. In 2016, she created Project Thrive, a recruitment and retention initiative that doubled the number of underrepresented students in her department within 2 years. Beyond Ohio State, she also serves and the Advisory Council of the Women Business Collaborative, an alliance whose vision is equal position, pay, and power for all business women. Dr. Turner will introduce the remainder of our speakers for the rest of our first session. Thank you very much, Dr. Turner, for joining us.
Thank you, Andrea, and good morning, all. I am so honored to be able to spend this next 45 minutes with all of you. I am particularly excited to share this moment with the esteemed women leaders who are on this panel today as we celebrate Women's History Month and address a most relevant and unfortunately still necessary topic of promoting gender equity. To get started, I would like to introduce my fellow panelists, beginning with Christine O'Malley. Christine O'Malley is a communications and marketing professional who has been a university staff member for 17 years. She is currently the senior communications consultant for the Office of Human Resources and serves as chair of the President's and Provost Council of Women, on women. Her previous roles at the university include leading communications and marketing for the Global One Health Initiative and as Communications and Alumni Affairs Director for the College of Public Health. Career highlights include being named as one of the PPCW's Glass Breakers in 2016, completing a Fulbright project in Ethiopia in 2014, and earning a master's degree in public policy from the John Glenn College of Public Affairs at Ohio State in 2010. She started her career in journalism as a newspaper reporter and editor. And then we have Andrea Silbert. Andrea Silbert joined the EOS Foundation as its first president in 2007. EOS is a private foundation making charitable investments in efforts to fight hunger and poverty and address structural barriers to gender and racial equity. Prior to EOS, Silbert was a candidate for Lieutenant Governor of Massachusetts, campaigning on a platform of job creation, economic development, and economic justice. In 1995, Silbert founded and served as the first CEO of the Center for Women and Enterprise, one of the nation's largest nonprofit entrepreneurial training centers. Silbert was a co-founder of Springboard Enterprises, a national organization which has helped fast growth women entrepreneurs raise over $2 billion in angel financing and venture capital. A nationally recognized advocate in the area of economic empowerment, Silbert was selected by Working Woman magazine, alongside Senator Barbara Mikulski and Gloria Steinem, as one of only 25 leaders in the past 25 years who have given women in the workplace a better shot. And last but not least, we have Emily Quick Shriver. Emily Quick Shriver is the Chief Executive Officer of the Matriots, a nonpartisan organization dedicated to electing more women to office in Ohio. Shriver brings a wealth of experience to the CEO position, most recently having served as Assistant Vice President and Senior Associate General Counsel at The Ohio State University. A 2005 graduate of The Ohio State University, she attended law school at Northwestern University, where she was selected for internships with then U.S. Senator Barack Obama and the Honorable Wayne Anderson of Illinois. And earning her law degree in 2008, Shriver then served as a law clerk for Honorable Richard Tallman, U.S. Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit in Seattle, Washington. A stint at Hogan Lovells, U.S. LLP, Washington, D.C., followed, in which she represented universities, corporations, and nonprofits on matters related to procurement, agreements, compliance, and litigation. Throughout her career, Shriver has been a dedicated advocate for diversity and inclusion activities. Welcome, ladies. As you can tell and see, we have a wonderful group of panelists today who can help us address ways of lessening and eliminating the power gap for women, whether in higher education or more broadly in society. Today's panel invites you to learn more about ongoing local and national initiatives and inspire momentum wherever you are. After a shared conversation, we'll reserve time to entertain questions from the audience. So please feel free to ask your questions in the Q&A function near the center of the screen. So let's begin. Christine, I'd like to have us begin more immediately by thinking about ways that Ohio State is making strides toward gender equity. The Women's Place was established at Ohio State in 2000 to support women's advancement throughout influencing policy and advocating for equitable working environments. In this work, one partner for the Women's Place is a university group called the President and Provost Council on Women. Christine, for those unfamiliar with this council, please share more about what you all do here at Ohio State.
Thank you, Dr. Turner. I'm happy to talk about that. And I just want to say I'm so excited to be here. I think this topic is incredibly important. As you noted, the Women's Place started in 2000. A year later, the President and Provost Council on Women was started as part of that, an arm of the Women's Place. We are a policy recommending advisory group, and we help make recommendations to the President and Provost and advocate for actions needed in the interest of women's progress. And things we've worked on in the past have included flexible work, childcare recommendations, leave policies, mentorship recommendations. And I think it was very telling in fall of 2020, the pandemic had started and we had a new president come in, President Christina Johnson, and she challenged our council to think over the next 10 years, what are those core areas that the university would need to progress on. And I the reason I say this was significant is because we had already entered the pandemic and she wasn't telling us to pause. She was telling us, think bigger. And so we identified four areas that we would like to see the university make progress in. Pay equity, mm-hmm. senior leadership representation, workplace culture, and work-life balance. And so we have continued our advocacy work during the pandemic on those areas. And so this topic, I think, is so important to me personally, but to I think it's important for society at large, because when you are in these moments of disruption, that's not the time to step back and put on the brakes. I mean, especially when we're seeing what we're seeing with the impact of the pandemic on women. And I know we're going to talk more about that later. But that kind of gives you a flavor of what the Council on Women at Ohio State is all about.
Thanks so much for sharing, Christine. Yeah, it is really very notable to, you know, recognize that, you know, our president continued to push forward when so many, unfortunately, decided to stop or pause. So this is so encouraging. And so I want to continue along those lines. Andrea, across the country, undergraduate women students often outnumber men, but those numbers alone do not tell the full story of what remains to be done. Here at Ohio State, the Women's Place publishes an annual report on the status of women at the university. This tracks data around the numbers of women as staff employees, professors at different ranks, and administrators. The EOS Foundation has been engaged in an even larger national project of tracing gendered patterns of compensation and leadership comparatively across research institutions. Andrew, please tell us more about these studies and what they found.
Thank you so much to both of you for that introduction and for the framing. I really appreciate that. I first want to say that, so we have done quite a bit of work nationally looking at the elite research universities. Those are R1 rated by the Carnegie classification. And Ohio State has done very well. And so I'm not surprised to hear that it started in 2020. In 2000 and was re-upped in 2020. So it's really exciting for me to be here. So what the EOS Foundation has done, we are a grant-making foundation, but we also do our own research because we're pushing really hard on gender and racial equity. And, you know, having grown up professionally working on women's entrepreneurship, I started seeing a backslide. Recently, we have not made a lot of progress since the 90s, and in some places we're backsliding. So we began looking at, in Massachusetts, in our own state, all of the colleges and universities, and we decided that our approach would be to find the data mm-hmm. around women and as much as possible racial and ethnic data, which is really hard to find, right? With women, you can dig it out with pronouns and photos, right?
Right.
So I'm a data wonk, and data will set us free. You know, all we ask is for a fair shake, but we can't measure. We can't. What is measured is managed, right?
That's right.
So I will get to that in just a minute. So we looked at, there were 93 colleges and universities in Massachusetts. This was in 2018. From community colleges up through these, we have 8 R1s. We have, you know, obviously many incredible research universities in Massachusetts. And what we found is we looked at the number of women deans, did they have women presidents, et cetera, across multiple categories. And then we ranked them from 1 to 93. Now this caused quite a stir because some schools who thought they were really great on mm-hmm. diversity, equity, inclusion were really low because mm-hmm. they were focusing on their students mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and they weren't focusing on leadership at the top. And frankly, they still don't. None of the schools divulge more than what you talked about. The Women's Place is gathering data from iPads. That's just professors, you know, mm-hmm. in the different levels. Mm-hmm. What we're suggesting is they've got to look at deans, they've got to look at the president cabinets, and most importantly, actually at boards of trustees. So we ranked them, and then we came back the next year and ranked them again. And some schools mm-hmm. had really taken efforts. Just surfacing the data, as my good friend Joyce Chen, who is another Ohio State person, we were just talking yesterday, and she said something that was spot on with our approach, which is just surfacing the data drives change. And mm-hmm. that's really what we're about. And we surface it in a comparative way. So I think most people are very good, well-intentioned in terms of promoting racial and gender equity, but they think they're doing everything they can.
Right.
Second, right. This is critical. They measure activity, but not outcomes.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I'll give one more. A third is that they tend to focus on training the women and training people of color versus changing the system. So we then graduated after we saw some good progress in Massachusetts. And we also brought together in a closed summit, the presidents and some of the board chairs of these universities. We then decided let's go national because the schools that were struggling the most were these elite universities. You know, they're more powerful. Mm-hmm. So we first released about a year ago, 10, who are the top 10 most highly compensated people? within each school. And then we did just recently what we call the power gap, the what Christine mentioned is the representation gap. We call it the power gap. Mm-hmm. And what we found is just, for instance, we focus very much on women of color. Women of color were getting 19% of the PhDs collectively, but only held 5% of the presidencies. Mm-hmm. Women were getting the majority of the PhDs, you know, 55%, and only held 22% women in aggregate, including white women. So, and the thing that was really striking was that women comprised about 40% of deans and provosts, which is the immediate position prior to becoming a president. Uh-huh. So there's a disconnect. And so we think that basically is unconscious bias, right? They're in the immediate position, they're applying, but they're not getting them. So they're 40% of provosts and deans, 22% of R1 presidents, and only 10% of the system presidents on campuses that have systems. So I'm eager to talk more and take questions about the work we've done and what we've found, but that's what we're doing. And we're gonna keep at it until things change.
You don't know how encouraging it is to hear that you are, you know, this data is being looked at and provided. You are absolutely right. Issues cannot be addressed unless you're willing to look at what they are, right? And so many times, like you say, that we're focused on the training, the activities, but not the outcome. So thank you so much for that. In fact, I want to follow up with on that. That there was an inside higher ed publication that did a brief on a study that showed that female senior faculty and top administrators earn more at institutions with female presidents and provosts, which is, again, another encouraging data point. What other practices or policies seem to work that we need to amplify to support gender equity? And that's for any of you on this panel.
I'll let someone else take a shot and then I'll fill in.
Okay.
Emily, I'm sure.
Emily, is that something you want to take? And, you know, I have some other questions if you want to come back to that, but I just think it's not surprising, but Emily, you want to take a shot at that?
Sure, I'm happy to. Hi, everyone, and thank you so much for including me in this panel today. This is such an engaging and interesting conversation, having come recently out of higher education and into this space, working with the Matriots. You know, I think that there are multiple policies, practices, pieces of legislation that affect gender gaps and that affect women and the way in which women are able to engage, whether it's in higher education or outside of higher education. And we see wage gap policies that trying to affect moving the wage gap forward, you know, removing the wage gap. But if you don't actually put those into practice, if you just kind of identify the fact that a wage gap is happening, that itself is not going to actually move the needle forward. You know, I focus on, my work is focusing on electing more women to office mm-hmm. in order to have the policies and practices and legislation that comes out of the political environment have a woman's set of eyes on it. There's so much policy that's being made that has been made historically that does not recognize the impact it might have on women. And there's no one in the room during the drafting of those policies that understands the impact it may have on a mm-hmm. whole subset of the community. And mm-hmm. the same is true for people of color, right? So what my organization is working to do is to elect more women in all levels of Ohio elected office in order to start to change policies and affect policies and practices, getting that gender appropriate lens put on policies and practices. And, you know, I think we're starting to see the effects of that. We're starting to move the needle here in Ohio, which is really important. I don't have specific current pieces of legislation at my fingertips, and I wish that I did, and I would tell you all to go out and I'd give you some information about how to ensure that you're able to testify and you're able to put forth some arguments from your own perspective to push pieces forward and get your voice out there in the legislative process. So I feel like I should have come with a few of those pieces of policy or legislation armed with those. But I really think I'm probably foreshadowing a bit, but the impact of the work that I do on higher education cannot be understated, right? There is a direct connection between politics, whether we like that word or we don't like that word, between politics and higher education. And in multiple different ways. And so as we look at ensuring that there is parity in our political offices, we understand that there's also this connection between ensuring that women and the work that women are doing on college campuses is also amplified in the connection between politics and higher education. And the first thing that comes to top of mind for me is funding, right? Mm-hmm. Our state legislatures, our federal government, significantly funds higher education, not just the undergraduate education, but also the research portfolio. So in order to be one of these R1 universities that Andrea is talking about, you need significant amount of federal funding from the government. What lens is being placed on that with regard to women, which women are actually able to secure federal funding for their research and their work, and how are we promoting those women through their research? Their research is just as important as a man's research. Let's make sure that we're getting the appropriate gender lens there. So the work that we're all doing in this space is highly highly influential in higher education. So I kind of took that a bit of a roundabout.
I'd love to connect what Emily said to what we're doing around advocacy. Mm-hmm. So as you mentioned, Dr. Turner, it matters if a woman's leading an organization. It has impact on other women and probably on race and gender, certainly if it's a woman of color, of course. So the representation matters, the power gap matters. So we've also seen that with women gaining political office. Women have gained significantly in the last 5 years, and they're getting elected, and women of color are getting elected in large numbers. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that we did with this data is we went to our highest ranked member of Congress in Massachusetts, mm-hmm. who is assistant speaker. Her name's Congresswoman Catherine Clark. Mm-hmm. And she has, her whole life has been devoted to women and children, and she pushed legislation in Massachusetts that, you know, after birth, women would be able to get mental health checks, screening checks. Actually, all women would be checked after birth for postpartum depression. I mean, she's just on it. Wow. So we brought this to her, and she said, "This is ridiculous." And I said, "What we'd like to see is these universities are getting hundreds of millions, billions of dollars, really, in research money from the federal government beyond, you know, the student loans and all of the other, they should have to disclose their diversity data. And let's start with the boards of trustees." So I'm going to make another example. So in some ways, and this is frightening, corporate America is way ahead of academia. Because in corporate America, you can't just have a board of directors and not tell data and not tell the diversity information. The asset managers, one in Massachusetts, State Street Global Advisors, just recently said they will vote down the slates of directors for any public company that doesn't reveal diversity data, have 30% women on their boards by 2023, and at least one person of color. We don't have an equivalent mechanism in higher ed, you know, that can hold higher ed accountable. So higher ed isn't accountable. Mm-hmm. And in our study, our most recent study, only 38% of the schools provided us with their board of trustees diversity data. 60% gave us president's cabinet, the deans, but the boards want to fly under the radar. Mm-hmm. And the boards, there were only 8 boards of directors that had reached parity among women. I mean, it's really, that's where everything begins. So anyway, so our member of Congress, again, link back to the Matriots and their great work. She's filing something at the federal level that basically, I don't know how it will come out, we're in early discussions, but basically would add to IPEDS. And we have a mechanism, it's really not that hard. The other route we might take is accreditation, you know? So, but that's my number one right now, is we have to make the boards of trustees, they choose, they select the presidents, and quite often they're a bunch of men, quite often white, and in finance, and they're donors. And that has to be diversified, because that group doesn't have the experience to necessarily select the right leaders for these university presidencies.
Wow. Andrea, my God. Listen, let me say that. So let me, it is, you know, being in these leadership roles now and being at the table, it is just so interesting when representation is not there, how in fact policies are created that so tone deaf to the issues that of, you know, as even the student population and our colleagues in so many spaces. So you're absolutely right. It's so critical at the upper echelons of management that we are represented in these spaces such that that policies and practices can be implemented where it's equitable. But it's hard. This is hard stuff, you know, because looking at that lens and saying, oh, through that lens and saying I'm working hard, but realizing that hard work is not being effective, it's sometimes a tough pill to swallow for many of those who are on these roles, correct? That are not representative of these, in the gender space. So I know you, Emily, you've already begun, you've pretty much introduced yourself to this other question. Christine, before I move forward, did you want to weigh in on this at all? Or you're fine for me to continue?
I think this is a great conversation. Only a couple of things I would point out is related to pay. And I think you quoted statistics that females earn more at universities that have women president and provosts. And I think that's related to the statistic that you also shared that you have more women leaders in those institutions as well. And so the more women you have in those higher ranks, the greater the pay equity is going to be when looked in aggregate. You still have women, you know, earlier in the pipeline, I think, that are still maybe challenged at those organizations. Yeah. I also want to mention how important it is to, on search committees, have women on search committees, but not just you know, somebody who has a uterus, but somebody who is aware of gender equity issues and is empowered to call those out in searches. And not just serving on the committee too, but the continuum of those searches, you know, who's onboarding a new person, who's meeting with final candidates. So, you know, all of that. So that's the only other thing I would just add to the conversation.
Excellent, excellent points. Thank you so much, Christine. Emily, I'm gonna continue with you. Many people don't think of themselves as political. So how do you get more women involved in considering a run for political office, particularly in these days and times where unfortunately we're so polarized and that some we're not, at, you know, especially at the highest levels, we are often not very effective because we're so polarized. And I just really think having more women at the table could lead us to some more effective ways of doing things, not just minimize what's taking place, but it's just so unfortunate what's going on right now. So how do you determine which candidates, first of all, how do you get women more involved in considering, or what would you suggest? And how, then secondly, how do you determine which candidates to endorse with your organization?
I love this question. This is a great one. And I think about it a lot. So I want to make sure I answer it, but first I want to piggyback on one thing that Andrea mentioned, which is the boards of trustees. So I want to conclude that thought, which is boards of trustees across the United States, especially for public institutions of higher education, are selected by the governor of the state. Mm. And so as we look at who's sitting in those high level executive seats in the state of Ohio, we have no women in the executive office for the state of Ohio. So as you look at who the advisors for the governor are in the state where you're looking at state institutions, you'll also wanna see who's advising them potentially on the selection of the individuals who are sitting on the boards of trustees. So that is another connection between politics and what's happening, especially at state institutions. For how do we select women to endorse, and how do we encourage women to run for office? There is research that says a woman needs to be asked multiple times to run mm-hmm. for office, mm-hmm. sometimes up to six times. Needs to be encouraged. She needs to have mentors. She needs people who are around her who she feels safe discussing running for office with. Additionally, what I'm seeing anecdotally from the women who are running for office is that they often have a why. It's not just that they know they'd be really good at it, but also they've had something happen in their lives mm-hmm. that tells them, this thing happened, I can correct it. It's not, nobody else is rising up to the occasion. I guess I'll put myself forward and run for office. And I think recognizing that talent among our women is so incredibly important. They have not seen themselves as a candidate. We have not normalized candidacy for women. And so one of the things that I've been trying to do in this role is normalize candidacy. Whether you win or you lose, sometimes you have to run multiple times in order to get your name out there. Sometimes you're not successful that first, second, third time. And that's really incredibly challenging to not be successful. But let's normalize candidacy and that women run for office. That's a thing we do. And then that women hold office. That's also a thing we do. So one of the things that I talk with my members about, and I talk with my candidates about, is that my own daughters, I have three of them, they are 11, 10, and 7, and one of their favorite make-believe games is run for office. So wow. they pick this up themselves as a game that they wanted to play, where they have a pretend office they're going to run for, and they're going to be on school board, or they're going to, and they rotate and stand up and pretend that they're giving a 2-minute stump speech. And so for them, when it comes time for them to vote, when it comes time for them to potentially be a candidate, it's not strange. They're not, they play with doll babies too. They play doctor, they do all those things, but one of the things they play is candidate. And so we're normalizing candidacy. And then also encouraging women, saying, recognizing the strength in the person around you and saying, you sound really thoughtful on these issues. Have you ever considered, have you ever thought about, because probably she hasn't. She Right. has not considered herself in the space of a politician. That's because right. because politics can often be a word we don't like to say. Instead, it's about representation. You have a beautiful voice. Put that voice forward in representing others, not being a politician, which has kind of a feel to it sometimes, but be a representative of the people and of your voice. And that has led to fantastic encouragement for women. Additionally, helping them recognize the network they already have or the network that I can provide to them or others can provide to them to learn how to run, to what do I do with my children when I'm running for office, mm-hmm. right? Currently campaign mm-hmm. funds can't be used for childcare. There's a bill in Ohio trying to change that. How do we ensure that they have a world around them that gets them connected to what they need so that they don't hear the I can't do it or the imposter syndrome things? They hear the I can and I will, and this is possible for me. The Matriots specifically, your other question was, how do we endorse? I think it's really important to harken back to Christine's point, which is it's not every woman. It is not every woman is out there able to really promote the health, safety, security, and rights of other women. We know that. So while we're nonpartisan, And so we endorse in on both sides of the aisle and in the middle of the aisle and to every side of the aisle. But what you need to do is you need to show us that you support the idea that women can thrive, an economy where women can thrive and prosper in Ohio. And we base that on five values, which are economic empowerment, dominion over our own bodies, access to education, diversity and inclusion and equity and independence, and healthy and safe communities in which to raise our families. And if you support those five values and you can show us historically how you've done that, maybe you've never run before, but what are some things in your life you've done to show us that you support those values, then we'll endorse you. And very importantly, we will give money, which is one of the hardest things for women to do, that it's hard to raise money. And so my organization, if we give you an endorsement, you get money with it.
Very good. So. Now, I there's one other question, because I know that for those who probably have said no five or six times, one of the things I'm certain that they really have to grapple with on that seventh time to say, hey, I will, you know, move forward, is this idea of, you know, the attack on character, the attack on, you know, on issues related to gender that want, you know, really tries to paint women in light, in a way, in a vein that, you know, often is not the case for men. How do you get those women to overcome, you know, those concerns and fears?
Something that we've been doing in the Matriots is creating networks of other candidates, people who have run for office before, creating I'm going to use quotes, but a safe space for you to ask those questions, to air those issues with other women who have run for office and maybe experienced those same things before. Our candidates have private groups where they chat with each other and just try to figure out, okay, I knocked on a door and this happened to me. And has this ever happened to you? And oh yeah, it did. And here's what I did. And, you know, has this ever happened for your children? What, you know, have your kids ever been questioned at school about this? How do you handle these situations? A lot of it is giving a support group to individuals to help them work out these questions and to give them a method, a plan for, okay, if this comes up for me, how am I going to handle it? There have also been some leadership circles created in Ohio that are not a Matriots thing, that are other organizations creating these groups of people who are all running in the same class for different offices to sit down and get to know each other. I think that's really important for moving policy and politics forward, but also to talk about these, you know, these real challenging things that have happened. You know, they questioned this, right? They questioned what my hair looks like. They questioned why are my children? Why am I not home feeding them dinner and instead I'm knocking on a door? You know, what normalizing it and then giving a support group where people can talk about openly and honestly about the challenges they're facing with solutions, not just to sit and talk about challenges, but to actually brainstorm solutions has been wonderful for our candidates. And they're very giving of their time.
Excellent. I'm hoping that those on the call are becoming more encouraged to think about this, because I know those are the kind of questions that come to mind and, you know, the doubts and concerns. So thank you for sharing. Now, for all of you and any of you can address this question, because I know you totally get this. For, you know, as we advocate for more women in power in politics, corporations and institutions, we know that there are also a few challenges women face, being the only one or the first, or encountering a glass cliff. The glass cliff is the phenomenon of white women or people of color being promoted or hired into leadership when organizations are already in crisis. This raises the bar for what they must do to achieve success in a crisis. How can women leaders and others from minoritized backgrounds leverage moments of crisis or transition, such as this pandemic period, to advocate for change? Who wants to take a stab at it first?
Well, I'll jump in. I think that advocacy during a time of disruption can be incredibly powerful. Mm-hmm. I here's my policy, public policy side coming through. You know, these disruptive moments present windows, right? They can sometimes be unpredictable windows. Mm-hmm. But what we need to do is be ready to drive a Mack truck through those windows, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so everything we do during, what may be normal our times, mm-hmm. Gets us ready for those moments. And so with the pandemic, it's not a shortcut for advocacy, right? You need to be ready to build on your years of knowledge building and coalition mm-hmm. building. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't view moments of disruption as, things that hold us back. I think as women leaders, moments of disruption are the most powerful moments. Right. And I would encourage everyone to be ambitious in those moments. Go for change that's major and permanent. That's why I was so amazed with President Johnson when she said mm-hmm. in the middle of a pandemic, think big over 10 years, what your council views as university's priorities for gender equity. Mm-hmm. And the other thing I would encourage women to do, women leaders, in these moments of disruption is keep your finger on the pulse of things. And I think that's what the Women's Place has done. And I give a lot of credit to Andrea Williams on that. In 2020, she deployed a survey, a pandemic survey mm-hmm. Across the university about women's experiences. That was information in the moment that several groups across the university have used since then in informing decision-making. So I would say to women leaders, these moments of disruption, don't let them hold you back. This is the time to jump right in and be ambitious.
And I want to add to that, absolutely. I'm going to add one small thing and one big thing that I would like to challenge Ohio State to look at, and your President Johnson. So at the small level, individually, all these women who are listening now, oftentimes women will leave or they'll find a better job before advocating with their current employer. So ask yourself, what would it take for me to stay? Mm. And I'll give you a little example. I went to Harvard Business School, and the past dean was speaking to a woman who was junior faculty and said, you have so much promise, do you see yourself rising here? And she said, well, I the one thing I'd ask you to change is stop having meetings after 6 p.m. Hmm. Like, that's small. Ask for that. What's been working for you working from home from the pandemic? Ask, could you stop having faculty meetings when I'm picking my kids off the bus? Maybe we could have it at 10 o'clock at night might work for me. Or can we do, some more asynchronous stuff? But ask, think, how do I make it work for me? The other thing I'm going to challenge Ohio State to do, because you're leading, right? So let's go one step further, because I love that. Think bold. So we talk about, we've talked about equal pay for equal work. Mm-hmm. But I talk about the raw pay gap, the fact that if you take all of the salaries at Ohio State, what do women make on average relative to what men make? And it's probably something like 75 cents, maybe 80 cents on the dollar. Mm-hmm. The way to address that is you have to address the power gap. You have to get the women from these junior positions up to the top. And the same goes for people of color. That should be measured. That should be measured in aggregate. And that should be shared with the university and saying, we're going to move this. It's going to take some time. Mm-hmm. But if you measure that, you're going to start seeing efforts to pull women up, to pull people of color up. So I would measure that across all census categories and intersectionally. So make sure it's not just Black average wage, it's Black women, Black men, Hispanic women, Hispanic women. We use the census categories, but intersectional data is critical. Otherwise, white women get ahead and men of color get ahead and women of color get left behind.
Wow. Emily, what would you like to add?
Oh my goodness, this conversation fills my heart, right? Because I think it is so solutions oriented. It looks at what can we do to really change for tomorrow. One of the challenges being a woman of color in higher education previous to this job, I would say that there isn't a focus on retention. So we focus really highly on getting. Gaining people and an influx of, okay, how do I ensure that I'm recruiting people for X, Y, or Z job? But then how do we ensure that they are sustaining once they are there? So that for me, I think, and maybe that's true for faculty as well, I was a staff member, but what kind of networks are we creating? What type of mentorship programs are we creating? What is the career trajectory? What's next for you once you get here? What systems do we have to support you while you're in higher education and help people really understand here's where you can go mm-hmm. once you've attained X, Y, and Z, either it's credentials or learning or connectivity or whatever it is, here's the trajectory for you. And giving people a pathway. I think it's really hard to incredibly focus on the recruitment effort. And then once you get there, there's not an easy way to see how your research partners with another person's research way across mm-hmm. campus, and there's not a method for navigating that. So I would say making sure that we have not only measuring the pay differences, but there's a way to provide support networks as well for people who are excited about coming to a university and being part of change.
Awesome. Well, we're coming to the end, and I wish I had another 45 minutes to engage with you all, because I'm just, again, being in this space and knowing that there are others that are really pushing and moving the needle as hard as it is sometimes. It's really very uplifting and inspiring. And so as we come to, today, I have two questions, and I would like each one of you to address. One is, how do you engage male allyship in your roles? And then lastly, what, one or two takeaways would you want those on this call to take from this this particular topic in this particular panel discussion? I'll start with Emily.
So how do we engage men? And I get this question a lot. I actually got it last night from the male moderator on a panel that I was on. He said, well, what about the men? And I said, this is a great question, because I cannot elect women to office without men, right? We need to ensure that men also understand the incredible impact that women running for office have and that women who will be elected have, and why it's important for the chief caregivers and the chief primary consumers in our state to have a seat at the table. And we're not trying to say 100% of the offices should be held by women, though, get me on a different day, I might say that, but 50% of the offices to be held by women. So we need men engaged in our process all along the way. And I have members who are men who say, this is so incredibly important that we have parity and that we hear the woman's voice. And then the second, I feel like you asked me two questions. The second was key takeaway.
Yeah, key takeaway. Give us one key takeaway you would want our viewers and listeners to leave here with.
One key takeaway I would have, and I saw it as a little bit of a question as well in the chat, it is that yes, everyone struggles with imposter syndrome, with insecurity, with fear, with a lack of clarity about pathway. I do on a daily basis, right? But it also is, you have within you the power to be able to achieve great change, even if it's incremental. Right. Mm-hmm. And even so, what you should be doing is, like Andrea said, advocating for yourself. Advocate if you see something happening for a friend, advocating for that friend, starting in that space and pushing forward. For me, I would say run for office. Right now, you got your first ask. If you've never had an ask, you have Emily Shriver from Matriot saying, run for office. You can make your voice heard. But there we all need to overcome fear and insecurity and imposter syndrome because our voice matters, your voice matters, and you can make change, I think is really what I would say as a key takeaway.
So in the interest of time, I'm just going to ask each, Andrea and Christine, if you would just give your key takeaway, and so we can, they won't get on my case for not ending properly, timely.
I'll be fast. Fix the system, not the women. Male allies, that's at you, right? So we shouldn't always have to advocate. You, as people in power, can ask people who report to you, what will it take to retain you here? What will it take for you? You ask, because we're not all the same. And so women are rationally nervous about asking for pay raises and other things, because there's data that says we don't get them. So it's at you. Male allies, but no more fixing the women. Fix the system, and you're a part of it.
Beautiful. Thank you. Christine?
All right. I'm just going to echo these two amazing women. Fix it for the women. You fix it for everyone, right? Yes. You fix the system for the women. You fix it for everyone. Then in terms of, being nervous or afraid, that saying your knees might be shaking, but your voice is strong. Be bold. And then the last thing I would say is we talked about, or Emily, you mentioned how, some women don't do anything until they're asked. When you're asked, jump in with both feet, but also be the asker. And very so good. those are my final takeaways, Dr. Turner.
Beautiful. Oh, wow. You all are true. You, each one of you rock, honestly. I so appreciate all of the insights, the wisdom, the fight, and all that you're doing to promote gender equity. So again, I speak on the behalf of all who are on this call. Thank you. Please keep doing what you're doing and inspiring us all and making a difference and making an impact. That's it for us. I hope for all of you on the call, you will remain for the next panel and discussions. This has been wonderful. Thank you all. Take care.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. Bye-bye.